Praise the Lord, it's good to have you all here this morning, and we are happy we've got Carolyn and Troy here this morning and their kids, and anyway, Carolyn is going to come up and she's going to play the piano this morning for us. So you can grab your hymn book this morning. We don't do that too often, but grab your hymn book. And we're going to sing a song this morning that we don't sing without her because I can't play my guitar. But turn number 398. And you know, this is a time in which we must be serious about our relationship with Jesus Christ and about what people see when they look at us, what we say, as we, you know, who are we identifying to be? So I think this is a great song to start out with, 398. It's hard, you know, with children seem to be hurt. And then also Carolyn and Troy will be going home after church today. And Surprised this fog leaves. Yeah. If we have anyone else.
At least the roads are good.
Yeah, roads are good. Yeah.
Except for the fog.
Yeah, except for the fog.
Doctor.
Well, excuse me, let's pray. Father, we thank you this morning. Well, the power of prayer again. Lord, we thank you for all the answers we have received over these years. Lord, you've been faithful to your word as we have stood upon it. Father, we pray this morning that you would touch these who are in need of prayer. Lord, we just pray for Matt Reese as he needs healing in his body, where he can't eat and is in the hospital. We pray, oh God, that you would work a miracle for him, and Lord, that you would be with his family as well. Lord, we pray for the Munson family, the loss of Randy. Lord, you know the heartache. And Lord, as they're planning the funeral and all, we just pray that you would give them wisdom, and Lord, help them to sleep at night and rest in you. And Lord, as they are desiring a move of God through all this, we pray that you would just even now be preparing those who will come, that they will respond to the beautiful message of the cross. We thank you, Lord Jesus, that you are God. And we just pray in Jesus' name for your mercy. We pray, Lord, this morning for little Lucy as she's got her burned fingers. Lord, we pray that you would just take the pain away. And Lord, we pray for a complete healing quickly, Lord, for that little girl. And Lord, just give Nathan and Charlotte mercy too as they care for her. She's a hurting little girl. Thank you, Lord, it wasn't worse. Lord, now we pray that you would just bless our service this morning. Thank you, Lord, we can all be together. We thank you, Lord, that Carolyn and Troy are here today and the kids. And we just pray your blessing on them, mercy, your protection as they drive home today. And Lord, just watch over them. Lord, we just give you praise now. We ask your blessing today upon our nation. And Lord, may there be a move of God. Bring people back to the cross. Lord, as all these campaigning is going on right now, we pray, open the eyes of people. But help them also to realize our hope is not in man, but it's in Jesus Christ. Father, we pray that you would also be with Israel today. Lord, as they stand basically alone, God, come to their side, open their eyes that they will see you in the side. We'll give you the praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. The scripture this morning is found in the book of Isaiah, chapter 53. And, it's supposed to be 55. Oh, wait, there's another verse. Isaiah 55. Find it. There we go. That's right. Okay, Isaiah 55, verses 6 through 11 says, seek ye the Lord while he may be found, call ye upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts, and let him return unto the Lord. And he will have mercy upon him and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, saith the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as the rain cometh down and the snow from heaven, and returneth not thither, but watereth the earth and maketh it bring forth in bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the things wherein or whereto I sent it. Amen. Aren't you glad the word of God is true? When God says it will happen, it will happen. And we're going to start out, we're going to sing some choruses this morning. There's always people that are put you down. There's always those that look on the dark side. And sometimes we look in the mirror and we say, "Oofta, I'm not sure I want to go in public today." And but who does God say that we are? That's the big thing. You can look in the mirror and say, "I am the temple of the Holy Ghost. I don't have to be afraid. I don't have to be discouraged. It's who God sees me as." Knowing not, you're the temple. Knowing not, you're the temple. Knowing not, you're the temple.
Let us worship the Lord in the holy of holies. Let us worship the Lord in the holy of holies. Let us worship the Lord in the holy of holies. Let us worship the Lord in the holy of holies. Let us worship the Lord in the holy of holies. Let us worship the Lord in the holy of holies. Let us worship the Lord in the holy of holies. Let us worship the Lord in the holy of holies. Let us worship the Lord in the holy of holies. Let us worship the Lord in the holy of holies. Let us worship the Lord in the holy of holies. Let us worship the Lord in the holy of holies. Let us worship the Lord in the holy of holies. Let us worship the Lord in the holy of holies. Let us worship the Lord in the holy of holies. Let us worship the Lord in the holy of holies. Let us worship the Lord in the holy of holies. Let us worship the Lord in the holy of holies. Let us worship the Lord in the holy of holies. Let us worship the Lord in the holy of holies. Let us worship the Lord in the holy of holies. Let us worship the Lord in the holy of holies. Let us wor Bring
Yourself, you would speak to our hearts. And Lord, that we will all know we have been today in the presence of our God. We are a needy people. And Lord, we just pray that you would meet those needs that only you can do. Speak to us, Lord. And may we hear what the Spirit would say to the church. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. The announcements for this week, by the way, we apologize for not having our Christmas stuff down yet. That's coming down today. And things get so busy, you know, around Christmas time. But they are coming down today. But our telecast again goes out Tuesday morning at 10 o'clock. And, you know, I'm just so excited because the hits on our website now are just about to hit 200,000. And that's a lot of people that are watching these telecasts. And but anyway, that's Tuesday morning at 10 o'clock, and then Wednesday night, you have Bible study at 6:30 at Sharon's. And then on Friday morning, we'll be having the funeral service for Randy Munson. And that's be visitation be at 10 o'clock, and then the 11 o'clock here at church is the service. Be much in prayer that God will just really touch a lot of hearts. And it's a tough time for the family. And so just keep them in your prayer. Something they've been dreading the thought of, but it's here. So be in prayer for them. And then next Sunday again, our Sunday worship, our Sunday school at 9:30 and worship at 11 next Sunday. Anything else that we need to bring up today? You know, this This little church has been around a long time. And, you know, it's kind of interesting, you know, for Carolyn and Troy's kids, you know, they're used to a mighty big church. A lot of different things going on there, and now we come here to a little country church.
Are we 140 years old this year?
I believe it is, yeah.
Well, let's celebrate.
Yes, it's 140 years. I wasn't here at the beginning, but not too long afterwards.
Neither were we.
Now, that people say, you know, you're getting kind of old, aren't you? Kind of. Not a bit. Not a bit. I'm still upright, so we'll keep going. But, but anyway, there's a lot of history in this little place. Think of how many people have met Jesus here. And that is so exciting. Their lives forever changed. Because one day they walked in those doors and heard that Jesus loved them. Well, this song kind of goes along with this.
Oh, I'd like you to go back to that old empty church and hear the songs of praise. Our people would sing in a big rapper's ring.
Oh, Peter wanted to preach this morning. He got up here in my pulpit and you couldn't see him, but he fell out of it. But you know, that happened to me one day when I was preaching not here. When I first started out, it was in a pulpit and it was a step or two up and I didn't realize it. And I got a little carried away and I stepped backwards and that disappeared. You know, that's downright embarrassing to fall out of a pulpit. Thank you, Jeremy. The message this morning, kind of a combination of things, I guess. But I've given the title of this message, Where Are We Now? And you say, oh, we're in church. But where are we now? Well, let's pray. Father, we ask that you would speak to us through the word today. And Lord, we pray that you would help us to put things together and understand the plan of God. The plans of man all fall apart. But your word has said that whatever you have said, it shall come to pass. And so, Lord, help us to keep our eyes focused on you and on your word. That shall, that faith shall arise and the enemy be scattered. But we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. The scripture I want to take you to this morning is really quite a long scripture, but it's found in the book of Ezekiel and chapter 37. Ezekiel chapter 37 says, The hand of the Lord was upon me and carried me out in the spirit of the Lord and set me down in the midst of the valley, which was full of bones. Oh, what a place to go. And you know, the prophets of old, now I've mentioned this number of times, the prophets of old did not try to get their emotions psyched up to get a prophecy. I'm afraid, I've been at prophetic conferences that were not prophetic at all. And, but a group of people got together and they were trying to get prophecies and they got people really hyped up and trying to, and pretty soon everybody's all excited. Now they're waiting for some prophecy because they're all hyped up. That does not, our emotions do not bring a message of God. God speaks when God wants to speak. You can't move him that way. Emotions are real. Emotions are wonderful. But when God has a message to speak, that is the time in which you better learn to hear. And further on, in this book, the people were now in Babylon. They've been carried away captive, and they came to Ezekiel, and they said, Seek the Lord for us and tell us what he wants to tell us. Well, Ezekiel, he went to the Lord and he asked him, God, what is your message for these people? And it wasn't the message that they wanted to hear. They were expecting some good news. You're all going to be set free. You're all going to go back to Jerusalem. Everything's going to be just like it used to be. But that wasn't the message God brought them. And so Ezekiel did not win a popularity contest. And God began to reveal the reason they were in captivity. And time again, he revealed the reason that they were in captivity. And in one situation, he brought them back and he showed them the temple in Jerusalem. And he showed them inside the temple a hole in the wall. And God said to Ezekiel, look through that hole. And Ezekiel got down that little hole. He looked through it, but what he saw on the other side terrified him. Because what he saw inside the temple was corruption among the priests. The very people that were supposed to be leading the children of Israel into holiness, to hear from God inside, where nobody could see, they were corrupt, they were immoral. And God says, I have seen what is going on in the very heart of the worship of this nation. And my judgment is here. Last week, I know I probably lost a little popularity with a few people not in this church. But those probably watching on TV probably didn't get too excited about it. But the heart of our relationship with Jesus Christ is repentance. We are planning on going into the kingdom of heaven, isn't that right? That's our goal. It's not to stay here. This world is getting to be a pretty bad place. But think what it's going to be like to step out of this world. Can you imagine what it's like to have a brand new body again? Just think, your heart's never going to speed up unless it's when you see Jesus. And that's going to be a good thing. You know, when you, as we get older, we get out of bed, and at least you start. Throw your feet over the edge of the bed and hope the rest of you doesn't land on the floor. You check everything out and make sure everything's working. Then you get up and go about your day. But the day is coming, we're going to get rid of these earthly bodies that keep breaking down. And we're going to get brand new ones. But the greatest thing of all, we are leaving a world of sin. We're leaving a world of corruption. We're leaving a world where you can't trust people. We're leaving a world where all these bad things go on. And we're going to a place that is holy. It is 100% pure. Imagine walking up to people and speaking to them and know that they are thinking good thoughts about you. Isn't that wonderful? That's what's going to happen. There will be no bad thoughts, no fears. There will not be one person in heaven who's depressed. The one who is depressed is the devil who's in hell. And he can be depressed. But heaven is a wonderful place. But heaven is a place where the holiness of God dwells and will never leave. Perfect. Absolute perfection. And that day is coming. That day is coming, and that's what we're looking forward to. We've got the precious promises of God. But the people wanted to have, when they came to Ezekiel, they wanted to hear good news about how God is going to bring them back and everything will be just fine. But what God is saying to those people through the mouth of the prophet, I know what's in your heart. and the corruption within your heart is still there. It hasn't changed. And what was going to happen was going to be very terrifying for these people. You see, God is saying, you are going to be scattered throughout the world. And they were. Israel lost their government. They lost their identity because they were no longer the children of Israel. Now they're Jews, yes, but they're scattered all over the world. But there's something about these people. They wanted to come back to Jerusalem. And there was that longing in their hearts in the days, the weeks, the months, the years to come. Always, no matter where they were, the dream is coming back to the city of Jerusalem, back to Israel again, where they again would become a nation. No nation in history has ever been dissolved and then come back and reestablished. But one, and that's Israel. Why? Because God said to Abraham, as he stood there, and God says, look at all this around you. He said, that is Israel. That is the land I have promised to you and to your descendants forever. Forever. God said to Abraham, and so, even though they were scattered, they drifted far into sin. And God said one day, I'm going to bring you back. That brings us back to our text. He said, he brought me to a place full of dry bones and caused me to pass by them round about. Behold, there were very many in the open valley, and lo, they were very dry. You know, it's something about death that is final. You walk out the cemetery out here, and you're not really expecting any exciting things to happen. They kind of stay there. They kind of quiet out there. And in our minds, that says final. But now God, I mean, he is saying this about Israel. Israel looked like it's impossible that they could ever come back again. Impossible. But God says it's going to happen. In the last days, it's going to happen. And so he goes on, he says, and verse 3, he says, and he said unto me, son of man, can these bones live? And I answered, O Lord God, thou knowest. And that's kind of a good way of saying, Lord, that's up to you. Again, he said to me, prophesy upon these bones and say unto them, O ye dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. You know, one thing that is happening today in America is there's churches closing their doors. They're closing their doors and they don't plan on ever opening them again. They say, how can it happen? How can it happen? And so the door is locked. Thus saith the Lord, verse 5. Thus saith the Lord God into these bones, behold, I will cause breath to enter into you and you will live. Now that sounds kind of far out, doesn't it? And I will lay sinews upon you and will bring up flesh upon you and cover you with skin and put breath in you, and ye shall live and ye shall know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied, Ezekiel says, as I was commanded. You know, when God calls us to do something, we better obey. What would have happened if Ezekiel would have said, impossible, I'm going home. And you know, I've thought this many times over the years as I've stood in the pulpit, God says, here's what I want you to say. And I said, oh God, you gotta be kidding me. You know it's not gonna be popular. But then the Lord says, man, you never were popular. So what are you worried about? He says, so I prophesied as I was commanded, and as I prophesied, there was a noise. And behold, a shaking, and the bones came together, bone to his bone. And when I beheld, lo, the sinews and the flesh came upon them, and the skin covered them above, and there was no breath in them. And so there was a visibility of something that was happening. And so bones were all of a sudden taking shape. In 1948, the bones began to come back together. There was a rattling during World War II. And Jews began to gather together, and it was like dry bones. It was an impossible thing. But what was going on in Germany, all the Jews being massacred, all of a sudden they began to rattle. And they began to come back. And in 1948, Israel again came together and became a nation. The first time in history this has happened. But they were brought from all corners of the earth, and they were brought back to Israel, and once again they became a nation. And it shocked the world. The problem was that even though they came back to Israel again, there was no breath in them. And I'm talking about the spiritual breath. Because these people still came back to, they came back to Israel just like the word says. But they still denied the fact that Jesus Christ is the Messiah. It is only when we make Jesus Christ our Lord and Savior that we live. It is by the Holy Spirit that we have breath. The breath of God breathed into us. And ever since, all these years have been going by, they are still claiming Messiah has not yet come. One time, we were in a store down in Minneapolis, actually, Bloomington, I believe it was. We're at a Target. And we're in a checkout line there, and there was a lady that walked up behind. And she was pushing a cart, and she was all excited, and she had some baby things in there. And she was the grandma, by the way, not the mom. She was the grandma, and grandmas can get a little excited. And she was all excited, and as we got closer, we turned and saw that, you know, she saw us looking at her basket with all the baby things. And she was telling us, she said, my son and his wife are going to have a baby. And she said, wouldn't it be wonderful if this baby turns out to be the Messiah we've been waiting for? She's a Jew that doesn't believe in Jesus. Another time I was in an airplane flying from New York. And a lady sat down next to me, and I began visiting with her. And I asked her where she was going, and she said, I'm going to Rockford, Illinois. I said, oh, you live there? She says, no. She said, I have one of my kids is there and their family. And I said, oh, you're going to celebrate Easter? It got strangely quiet. She says, no, I'm going to celebrate the Passover. She's a Jew. And this was too much for this preacher to sit on. And I began telling her about how Jesus Christ fulfills all the promises of what the Messiah is going to be. And I was expecting, she couldn't get up and walk away. The first step down was a long one, you know. And so she stayed, had to sit there. But she didn't get upset. She began to listen. And she sat and she started asking questions. And she began to listen as to what the good news of who the Messiah is, that he has already been born. He has already fulfilled the task of going to the cross of Calvary. And she said, oh, wow, I didn't know that. Oh, oh, what an exciting time. That was one fun flight. And I could just almost picture the breath of God getting ready to blow and give her life. Where are we today? We are sitting in a time in which prophecies are being fulfilled so fast. The Bible says in the last days, he says, watch as Jerusalem is encompassed around about by armies. You know the time is right. Today Israel is being attacked on seven fronts. Isn't that something? And the day is coming in which Israel will be all alone. Today our government, our president, has turned against Israel, telling Israel the land has to be divided. You've got to get half of it to the Muslims. He's telling them you got to quit fighting. And he's telling them these things are your fault. What's going on? But the word was said to Abraham, he who blesses you, I will bless. He that curses you, I will curse. Where are we standing today? This we know according to the word of God. This should not frighten us. It shouldn't terrify us. Because before we can go much farther in what's going on in the world, there's going to be the greatest airlift man has ever known. Jesus Christ is coming again. He's coming again. There's going to be a shout. There's going to be a sound of the trumpet. The dead in Christ shall rise first, and we which are alive and remain shall be caught up to be with the Lord in the air. Can you imagine what it's going to be like? Just be standing out here in the cemetery, probably putting flowers in a grave. Not right now. But when it gets a little warmer. Imagine out there standing there putting flowers on the grave, and all of a sudden, poof, they're gone. I'll tell you, even us Norwegians who know the Lord would get excited. Would get excited. The dead in Christ shall rise first, then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up to be with the Lord. Yesterday we went to a wedding. And it was fun. David's grandson got married. And, there's an excitement in there. But there's something that goes on before the wedding. There's a lot of stress, isn't it? You don't understand the stress of the wedding until you're the bride. And I love to talk to the brides beforehand and say, well, how's it going? Oh, fine. And then you talk a little longer and then you find out, it's not fine. I got this to do, I got that to do, I got that to do, I'm running out of time, woe is me. But yet excited. Before the bride of Christ is caught up to be with him, it's a time of stress. It's a time in which we are caught up in all the activities We know it, the day is coming. We know it's coming soon. We just don't know what day. But you look at the bride and the reason she's willing to go through the strife, all the struggle of getting ready, because she is in love. She's in love and she's waiting to be united to her bridegroom. We watched that wedding last night, you know, yesterday, and those two, they were grinning from ear to ear. You know, I have never yet seen a bride or a groom standing up there yawning as the wedding is progressing. We're just about done. There's a ball game going on at home. I want to get back and watch the rest of it. There's only one thing on their mind, is that wedding. And the reason it's on their mind is because of the love they have for each other. God gives us weddings to reveal to us, to show us what is coming for the bride of Christ, but we can understand it. How excited are you about the wedding? You know, that bride, as she was ready to start coming down the aisle, the music all of a sudden changes, and here she comes. Everybody turns around and looking, and she's got a grin on her face. She's smiling, probably nervous as all get up, but she's still smiling. Her eyes are upon the young man that's standing in front waiting for her. And they go through all the vows, everything, you know, up front. And finally, the pastor says, I'm going to pronounce you husband and wife. He turns to the groom and he says, you may now kiss your bride. And the bride and the groom says, do I have to? Well, I suppose I better. It's a thing to do. But you know what? That's what's happening in churches today. Instead of anticipating seeing the bridegroom, there's so many people that are so caught up in worldly activities that they're not looking forward to being in the arms of the bridegroom. The Bible says Jesus is coming for a bride without spot or wrinkle. This is the bride that has had the breath of God breathed in. I'm not going to read the rest of this chapter because you're going to miss dinner. So I'm just going to cut it short. Ezekiel sees these bodies coming together. Just like Israel came together. And then God breathed into them and they became living souls. Then they stood up. A great and mighty army. A group of people now, they're on their feet. Now they're alive. Israel is still rattling. But they have to come alive. And the Bible says in the last days, and this will take place, there are those who are getting saved right now recognizing that Jesus is Messiah. Praise God. But Jesus is coming for his bride. And then for 7 years, it's going to be one terrible time in Israel. It's called the time of Jacob's trouble, the great tribulation. And during that time, there's going to be 144,000 Jews that get saved and become missionaries that are going to be traveling the world, spreading the gospel, and God's protection will be on them for a while. There will be a great revival. People will get saved. But they will eventually lose their life and stand before God, tribulation saints. But in the end, it says all of Israel will get saved. When will they get saved? At the very end of the tribulation, they see Jesus coming through the clouds. Yeah. With his bride, as we come down with Jesus Christ, they will then recognize him as Messiah. And all that's left are going to recognize and say, he is the Messiah. Time is moving very quickly. Why am I preaching this message? The wedding is getting close. How excited about are you about the bridegroom? I loved it last night watching this thing, and my message is going through my mind as I'm watching the wedding. As the bride and the groom, you know, looking at each other, finally the wedding is done. And now we're in the reception, and they had a little jar there, and they said, anybody who wants can put some money in the jar. It goes to the bride and the groom, by the way. And then you can ring a bell. And the bride and the groom, they have to stand up and they have to kiss. And they didn't mind at all. When they started, Kevin, he says, I hope they got chapstick. That's experience. The excitement of the wedding is for those who truly are in love. If you are in love with Jesus, and if you desire above all else to see him, he is number one. You will pray even as John prayed at the end of Revelation. Even so come, Lord Jesus. But in the meantime, even in the meantime, as we're getting close to the wedding, one of the things the bride and the groom do is they send out invitations. And some of the invitations didn't get out, so I got a message on my phone that says, are you coming to the wedding? And you know something? That is the message of the church today. Are you so in love with Jesus, so anticipating his coming for his bride, that you can't help but tell people, are you coming? Are you coming? And I text back, I says, yep, I'll be there. And I got another one back, good, good. You know, just lower a year and a half ago, when you made that decision, I'm coming. Do you know something, Pat? When you and Lori made that decision, sitting right where you're sitting, Lori's sitting right up here, it made 50 years of ministry worthwhile. You know, what my life has been is for that very thing. You can show me a picture of a church all over this country. And when I see that picture, I can see not a face, but I can see exactly in that church where someone gave their life to Christ. There's nothing more perfect. And I beg you today, be so excited about seeing Jesus that you can't keep your mouth shut, but make sure the invitations are out. that people will see and want to know him. And that they will be right with God. That's the church. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you today that you are calling us, Lord, to be a voice in the wilderness. That even though the trials are around us and we see much suffering, it is in the sufferings that people realize they need Jesus. The world cannot satisfy. And Lord, we pray you would put the fire of God in our heart, in our soul. Lord, that we want to make sure that people know who Jesus is and have invited him into their life. God, give us one more soul before the sound of the trumpet. May we be the true bride of Christ, longing to look into your eyes and held in your arms. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to do one more song, number 399, your hymn book. 399. Nothing we can do You did it all. You gave your life upon the cross so we could be saved, we could have our sins forgiven. And Lord, our job is to turn to you and ask you to be our Savior, confessing our sin, admitting we can't do anything to merit eternal life, but put our faith in what you did. And so, Lord, we ask right now that anyone watching this today, if they're not sure that their sins are forgiven, that they will just pray this simple prayer and say, Jesus, I want to go to heaven one day. But your Bible says my sins have separated me from God. And you cannot allow sin into heaven. So I have to get rid of all my sin. And I know the only way is for you to take it out. Would you forgive me? Take my sin away. Wash me and make me clean. I give you my habits. I give you my failures. I give it all to you. And I ask you, be my Savior right now. I put my faith in your promises, which says if I confess my sin, you are faithful and just to forgive me of my sin and cleanse me of all unrighteousness. I put my faith in your word, and I receive you as my Savior right now, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above me, heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Amen. God bless you, and thank you, Carolyn, for playing for us. God bless.